So thank you, Zohar, for inviting me, and thank you, of course, for this fantastic conference. This is a joint project with Professor Gideon Parchomovsky, in which we explore a new phenomena that we term the reverse agency problem. So in order to better understand this problem, let me begin with a very short introduction, a very short background regarding the classic agency problem. So as we all know, the story begins in 1932 in the seminal book of Berlin Mintz, in which they explored the relationships between shareholders and managers and the separation of ownership and control. According to their thesis, vast majority of the public companies in the US are widely held by minor shareholders that have little interest in the day-to-day management and have little chance to influence the corporate decision making. As a consequence, the control of the companies had then shifted from shareholders and directors, and the problem became that managers and directors could shirk their duties and responsibilities and divert the value of the company. This problem is commonly termed the agency problem. And the idea that managers and directors sacrifice the companies in order to promote their self-narrow interests was both correct and intuitive. And basically, it wouldn't be an exaggeration to say that since the book was published, the agency problem has been the focal point of the corporate law theory. And a recent, very important contribution has been made by Goshen and Squire in the recent article in which they developed the principal cost theory. Oddly, in recent years, we are witnessing a mirror image problem. Now, companies are willing to sacrifice their directors and officers for the sake of their best interests. It is no accident that this new phenomena, this new problem has gone unnoticed. So far, it is a new phenomena. The reverse agency problem is a byproduct of the new age of compliance. Since the beginning of the millennium, enforcement authorities in the US have started to direct the resources towards enforcement of public companies. Enforcement authorities now initiate criminal investigations against public companies, and this slide illustrates this point. We can see the increasing numbers of enforcement actions initiated by the DOJ and the SEC combined regarding the FCPA. I promise you that a similar trend can be traced in the enforcement of other rules and regulations. Interestingly, the vast majority of these criminal investigations do not bring criminal charges against public companies. Instead, these investigations are settled out of the court in the form of pretrial diversion agreements, mainly deferred prosecution agreements and non-prosecution agreements. And this trend can be explained by the combination of legal reasons and business economic reasons. As of the legal business, public companies are aware of the fact that the DOJ can use legal doctrines that provide it with a very strong basis to submit indictment and pursue criminal conviction of the public companies. First legal doctrine is the respondent superior doctrine that make it possible to impose criminal liability on public companies even though a low level agent, a low level employee of the company committed the offense, committed the crime. This is the first doctrine. The second doctrine is the collective knowledge doctrine, according to which there is no need that one single employee of the company committed all of the elements of the offense. Instead, the DOJ and the court can take several elements from different agents of the company and then make an aggregation and attribute all of the needed elements to the company. The bottom line is the combination of these two legal doctrines make it very easy for the DOJ to charge public companies that make business in the US. As of the business reasons, so public companies are aware of the dramatic negative consequences of indictment, not to say conviction. An often cited example is the case of the audit firm Arthur Andersen that was charged in 2002 by the SEC, convicted by the district court in 2002. The Court of Appeals approved the conviction, and indeed in 2005 the Supreme Court of the US overturned the conviction, but it was too late. Arthur Andersen lost its license to conduct an audit investigation in public companies in the US, and it was like a death sentence for Andersen, and put Andersen, that was one of the big five in the US, out of business, out of the market. The combination of legal and economic reasons can explain why companies run to settle with the DOJ and the other enforcement authorities like the IRS and the SEC at all cost. This slide illustrates the growing use, the dramatic increase in the numbers of the pretrial diversion agreements since the beginning of the millennium until now. We can see that in 2001, we had only 3 pretrial diversion agreements compared to more than 100 in 2015. The signing on these agreements enhance the value of the company and maximize the profits of the shareholders. However, the signing under pressure on these pretrial diversion agreements make companies to sacrifice directors and officers. And let me illustrate this point by 3 representatives aspects of the reverse agency problem that take place all over the enforcement process at different stages of the enforcement process. So the first aspect is related to the first stage of the criminal investigation. In order to enter into a pretrial diversion agreement with the DOJ, the corporate must cooperate fully with the DOJ, and this includes even to provide the DOJ privileged documents and even waiving attorney-client privilege, immediately putting directors and officers at personal risk. In order to illustrate how companies sacrifice directors and officers, let me refer to a statement made by Judge Kaplan in the very famous case of KPMG. According to the Judge Kaplan, the government encouraged KPMG to press the employees to cooperate. In each case, KPMG reiterated its threat to cut off payment of the legal fees unless the government were satisfied with the individual cooperation. In some cases, KPMG told the employees to cooperate with prosecutors or be fired. This is the first aspect of the reverse agency problem. The second aspect is related to the stage of negotiation and finalization of the pretrial diversion agreements.
In these agreements, companies are required to admit to various counts of wrongdoing by its directors and officers. Interestingly, many of whom are no longer employed by the company and have no say in the process of negotiation. In that regard, it is useful to refer to a very famous statement of Professor Richard Epstein that called these confessions made in the statement of facts that are an integral part of the pretrial diversion agreements, according to which confessions, these are confessions of a Stalinist purge trial. Third and final aspect is related to the follow-up suits, the follow-on suits. The admissions in the pretrial diversion agreements speak volumes about failures of directors and involvement of officers. They are drafted in a very strong language that invites shareholders to sue directors and officers. Interestingly, along the years, most of the follow-up suits that were filed in the wake of the enforcement actions have been dismissed or settled. In order to ameliorate the reverse agency problem, we consider three potential solutions. Before explaining about each and every solution, let me say that the root cause of the reverse agency problem is the pooling effect created by the agreements, meaning the collective treatment of directors and officers in the agreements. Directors and officers do not have the chance to distinguish themselves from their peers, from their colleagues, meaning diligent and innocent directors and officers do not have the chance to clean their names. The first solution is to provide interested directors and officers the right to a hearing before the enforcement authority. This would take place at the end of the criminal investigation and before the finalization and the signing on the agreement. Directors and officers would be able to review statements made about them, to consider the accuracy of the statements, and to propose amendments to the agreements. This solution, by its very nature, relies on the enforcement authority. The second solution to the reverse agency problem is to grant directors and officers the right to seek a declaratory judgment in court. This would allow directors and officers to clean their names, to prevent the automatic filing of the follow-on suits, and to carry on with their careers. We propose that if successful, directors and officers would be able to receive indemnification from their companies for legal fees. Third and final solution is to give innocent directors and officers a legal recourse against their colleagues that were involved in the wrongdoing and brought about the criminal investigation. The implementation of this solution required the law to recognize a new fiduciary duty applied horizontally among directors and officers inter se. Thank you very much.